All right, everyone, go ahead and take your seats. We're about to begin our second session. If you're joining us on YouTube or Facebook, definitely go over to yaf.org/virtualpass and submit your questions for the speaker. We'll be taking those as soon as he's done with his lecture. And you all heard from him this morning. So why don't we give a nice, warm welcome to Dr. Burt Folsom once again.
Thank you. Good. Someone in this room has the right to call me a socialist. I was signing books, and I redistributed their pen to my pocket. Whose did I take? Please come and get it back. Thank you. Very good. How many of you, because we're going to talk about the Great Depression, the 1930s, 1920s, we're going to do it today. How many have, that's a big issue when you're in your history courses, the Great Depression. Who was president? FDR, Franklin D. Roosevelt. You hear now about the Green New Deal nowadays, right? That's based on the old New Deal, which we're going to talk about some. And how many of you in your classes have teachers who are, I mean, they're sympathetic to Roosevelt and a lot of what he did? Wow. Okay. How many have teachers who are critical of Roosevelt? I mean, critical, saying he shouldn't have done so much intervention near towards social. A few. Are you, what high school? Is it a public high school?
Charter school.
Okay. Who else is it? I did this once. He says, I'm homeschooled. It's my mother.
It was an online class.
An online class. Or did you?
It's a private school.
A public school critical of Roosevelt.
Yeah.
But some publics, they're critical of Roosevelt, saying we needed to do more socialist activities in the economy. But that's, is that this? Oh, it is. Yeah, okay. Well, there you go. There are not too many. How many of you, though, have parents who are a little bit critical of Roosevelt, maybe? Okay. Very good. Well, this is important because Franklin Roosevelt is highly esteemed by American historians. He's ranked ahead of George Washington by American historians. And we need to look at what he did and analyze it. The first thing, you know, I've written a book called New Deal or Raw Deal. And before I go on, is Donnie here? Donnie, for answering my questions on the telegraph and pointing out the importance of incentives, I want to give you a copy, Donnie, of my New Deal or Raw Deal book. Thank you. I have another one I'm going to give away, and the sequel book, too. But let's, before we get into that specifically, I want to talk about the 30s, because we have to settle some things. We have a very prosperous decade before the 30s, extremely prosperous. And a lot of confusion has happened, saying, well, wait a minute, somehow that huge burst of free enterprise before the Depression is linked with causing it. That's what I heard from some of my teachers. I thought, wait a minute, how could the economy just be rolling around and it causes a depression? I want to get to that a little bit. I want to talk about the 20s, talk a little bit about the Depression itself, and then talk about Franklin Roosevelt in his program, the New Deal, and look at the whole thing, because it's the closest time we've come to socialism in U.S. history. Socialist ideas were really in the air and widely discussed, and in some cases put into practice in the 1930s. And we need to look at all this. Because when we looked at last time at the telegraph, we found it didn't work so well. Well, what about the 1930s? We're going to look at that too. Let me talk about the 20s first. The 20s actually was part of our quote a little bit from Ronald Reagan. And I want to go over that again. Remember, each new generation has to think again about freedom. Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. Freedom is never more than one generation from extinction. We didn't pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. And so what we think about here is we had that big burst of entrepreneurship with all the creativity that I talked about in the 1800s. We got into the 1900s. We had a question on Theodore Roosevelt. It's never more than a generation away, and it began to be challenged in the 20th century. Once we hit about the World War I era, the end of the 19-teens and into the 1920s, we had the income tax. The income tax became a progressive tax. What do we mean by a progressive tax? Yes?
It changes per level of wage bracket.
Right, it changes. Does it go up or down?
Down if you make less.
Okay, up if you make more. Right, it's the more you make, the greater percentage we take. Progressive. We ended up making, putting in a progressive tax. It was huge. It was going to take almost three out of every $4 that wealthy people earned. And in the 1920s, the big issue was, what are we going to do about this? Because the economy had stalled and we had 12% unemployment. People weren't investing because they said, if they're going to take that much of my money, I'm not going to invest it, because if I'm successful in my investment, then they take it from me. If I'm unsuccessful, then I lose the money because it's unsuccessful. So we had a real pullback. And who was elected in the 20s? Who are our presidents in the 20s?
Calvin Coolidge.
And who was the one that was before? Coolidge was vice president, who became president when this other, when his boss died. He was after Coolidge. Does anybody know who the one?
Warren Harding.
Right. To many historians, he's a joke, but Warren Harding did a lot of good things, and so did Coolidge. They got the rates back down. So they said, instead of having to pay $3 out of $4 that you make if you earn a lot at the top end of incomes, you only have to pay $1 out of $4. So we got those rates down, and all of a sudden investment comes back into the economy. And I wanted to go over with you, because this burst of investment, it was so great, we went from 12% unemployment to 2.4% in 2 years. Boom! All of a sudden we told people, you get to keep what you make. And then people, or at least a lot of what you make, and then we had this flurry of investments. And I wanted to go through some of them because they're interesting. You look at California. Here's the first one I want to give at. Really made a difference. Not so much in Santa Barbara, but other parts of the state. Air conditioning. Whew. I live in Atlanta a lot of the year. And Atlanta, before air conditioning, was smaller than Akron, Ohio. And then air conditioning came, and all of a sudden, Atlanta became an option for industry and industrialists who thought about moving down there. California benefited too. Willis Carrier. Air conditioning was first used. Would anybody have a guess what air conditioning was first used for in the 1920s? You would think it might be something in industry or meatpacking, but no, actually not.
Movie theaters.
Yeah, very good. Movie theaters. Yes, movie theaters, because in the summer it would be hot in the theater and attendance at the movies dropped off. So a New York theater named the Rivoli in 1924, this is in the Roaring Twenties here, experimented and put in air conditioning, and they found out the attendance was all of a sudden huge at their movies. We had over 300 theaters that had air conditioning by the end of the 20s, and then other businesses and industries began to use air conditioning as well. Huge invention of the 20s. Movie theaters, with the increased business, they innovated. See, one innovation often leads to another. Talking movies came in 1927. Warner Brothers did that. The Jazz Singer was the name of the first talking movie. Let's see. Oh, I like this one. It was called Hookless Number 2. invented by an immigrant, Gideon Sunback. Hookless number two. Anybody know what that was? That's a tough one. The zipper. We invented the zipper in the 1920s. Before that, we used buttons for clothing. Gideon Sunback, when he took his zipper to the patent office, they looked at it. You know, they're showing zip, 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 zip. Okay. He says, we're generous at the patent office, so we're going to give you a patent. But I can't imagine a use for it. Can you imagine that? We all are using, at least I hope we're using it, and I hope mine is functioning and all of this, that our zippers are. Listen, it's amazing. It's something that is so common today. But it took clothing people, and it started with galoshes was the first zip-up galoshes. In fact, the hookless number two is still on it, and they turned the galoshes. B.F. Goodrich was making galoshes, and they turned it over to their advertisers, and they had a caption of a woman, and the caption, she was zipping up her galoshes, and it was zip her up. And the word zipper came into use, 1920s. Important invention. Some of you know radio came in a big way in the 20s. The clothes dryer, invented by George Sampson. The dishwasher, invented by Josephine Cochran. Now, what's interesting about a lot of these inventions is they represent, it's a melting pot of America, because it's not like the upper class has an advantage, and like some of them do, and try to get into schools by buying their way. You can't buy your way into entrepreneurial success. Willis Carrier was an engineer. The movies, Warner Brothers, were Jewish immigrants who did the jazz singer with the movies. The zipper, Gideon Sunback, was a Swedish immigrant. Clothes dryer, George Sampson, was Black American. The dishwasher, Josephine Cochran, woman. And then, perhaps my favorite of them all, something that I enjoyed yesterday and up on the roof today, I had the pleasure of watching many of you enjoy as well. The invention in 1924 in Pasadena, California, of the cheeseburger. I had one at our Santa Barbara establishment, which Pat Coyle got me into the habit of attending. The Habit is the name of it. A delicious, while you were all at the Reagan Ranch, I was eating my cheeseburger and enjoying it and thinking of Lionel Sternberger. Isn't it neat that burger is his part of his name? Sternberger invented the cheeseburger in Pasadena, California, and Lionel Sternberger was 16 years old. So we have now, among our entrepreneurs of the Roaring Twenties, we have an engineer, a Jewish immigrant, a Swedish immigrant, a Black American, a woman, and a teenager. I wish I could say Lionel Sternberger lived well. A lot of times it's good to use your invention, right? I mean, if you invent the iPhone, you want to use it. He invented the cheeseburger and used too many and died young. But still, he invented it, and we need to give him credit. We have this array of inventions that are part of our lives, and the economy was going so well that Calvin Coolidge had a lower unemployment rate and a lower inflation rate than any other president since we've been calculating the numbers. American prosperity was so great that in the 1920s, our GNP grew so much, it's the equivalent of adding modern-day California and Texas on in a decade, those two economies. A 25% economic growth in a decade. Low unemployment, so I mean college enrollments, double. Life expectancy increased more in the 20s than any other decade since we've been calculating. Although it was still only 59 years old at the end of the decade, it went from 54 to 59. So many good things happened in the 1920s. You're thinking, well, what in the world could go wrong? What went wrong could be described in one word. Hoover. The Republican Party, with Herbert Hoover, was divided into two parts. He would be called today a rhino, Hoover. And you had Coolidge and Harding, who were solid conservatives. Hoover got in, and he began to say, we need to meddle, we need to tinker. He wasn't not a socialist, I don't want to say that. But he wanted to definitely have lots of interventions. He thought, we can fine-tune with the government and make things better. And so, among other things, he thought, gee, a lot of things, watchmakers are having low employment because Switzerland makes the best watches in the world, and they sell their watches. These are prices back in 1928 and 29. They sell their watches for $1.50, and they keep perfect time, and the American watches, we had to wind watches back in those days. American watches were $3, and you'd wind it up, and it would run the hour, like a race, in 58 minutes. And so every morning and evening, you would reset your watch. And the Swiss watches kept perfect time. Well, now, gee, I wonder, would you rather buy a Swiss watch at $1.50 or an American watch at almost $3 that doesn't work as well? Well, it shouldn't surprise anybody that the watchmakers in Rhode Island and Connecticut and New England were not selling too many watches. So they said, they got their senators and said, why don't we put in a high protective tariff on Swiss watches? And they said, okay, well, we could make them $4. And they said, no, make them even more than that. It has to be $5 because they'll still want to buy them because they're better. So we put a tax of over $3 on every imported Swiss watch, this huge tariff. And then the American watches begin to sell more. And Hoover said, see, I've helped the American economy. The problem is, he did this with product after product, sugar. We import from Cuba, for example, a lot. Well, there was beet sugar, which you could do in Midwestern states. I mean, in Nebraska, my state, or Utah. Utah, I mean, you're from Utah. Is it today beet sugar still a big industry in Utah?
Not as big as it was. Yeah.
Okay. It was bigger earlier. It was huge in the 20s and 30s. And they say, well, let's do sugar. But the Cuban sugar is cheaper, so put a big tariff on the Cuban sugar. So they said, they said to the New England people, we'll vote for your watch tariff if you'll vote for our sugar tariff. And then everybody around the country was having these products that weren't very competitive, and we got high tariff. We passed the highest tariff in U.S. history, and Herbert Hoover supported it and signed it. Even though 1,000 economists signed a petition saying, veto it! Veto! No, he signed it. And once he signed it, the American foreign economy went reeling because the people in Switzerland, it's their number one industry, watchmaking. We're their number one customer. All of a sudden, we're hardly buying any watches. We're back to the Central Pacific question. What did the Swiss watchmakers do? A, they turned the other cheek and said, we're not going to do anything. B, they said, aw shucks. C, they put a tariff in on all U.S. products to counter that. So their local industries, even the ones that like farming, wheat and all this that weren't very competitive with Americans, even they're just putting everything on so that they hurt Americans. How many know it's C? You're right. In fact, our ambassador, it was funny, our ambassador to Switzerland, you know, we had the phone. Remember, we got good communications. We've got those. He said, I need to talk to Washington. Washington, quickly. He says, I'm hiding in my room. We have an embassy and our ambassadors. I'm hiding. They're burning Uncle Sam in effigy out here in Switzerland because of the tariff. And come help me in the middle of the night. Get me out of here before they lynch me as well. Europeans all over began to put high tariffs on American products. And American exports went down. Automobiles, farm products, which we sell a lot of abroad. Our farm market went down, and the prices of farm products go down. Automobiles, Hillsdale College, where I teach, is in Michigan. Michigan is an auto center. at least it was. And back in the 20s, it was huge with Ford, General Motors, and Chrysler. In Michigan, which was the main place that cars were made in the 1920s, America, we sold about 5 million automobiles a year in the late 20s. By 1932, because the foreign purchases got cut off completely, we were down to 1.6 million. In other words, I'm telling you, the automakers in Michigan were in a depression. The farmers with their low prices because we couldn't sell our wheat abroad were in a depression. And you see that with the Great Depression. The second thing that now I can't really blame this on Hoover, but the Federal Reserve raised interest rates, making money harder to borrow. Milton Friedman, who won a Nobel Prize because of his book on the Great Depression, A Monetary History of the United States, it was really covered more than the Depression, but that was the part that got the most attention. He argued that this was really the main cause of the Great Depression, even more than the tariff. Herbert Hoover then said, what we need to do is have more government programs for people who are in trouble because of unemployment. Therefore, I'm going to raise the income tax to get more money. And so the tax went from $1 out of $4, 25%, to 63%. And with other taxes and regulations, it was closer to $3 out of $4 that you're paying in taxes if you are rich. $3 out of $4 if you're rich. Do you think that will have an impact on investors? Let me do some. Who here? How many here? We'll do some role playing here. We'll say I'm your teacher. I'm also going to play the role of a government bureaucrat. Who here can do 10 push-ups for us? Sure. Oh gosh, lots would be willing to volunteer to do. Okay, who can do 10 push-ups? And do it. You have to do it in front of everybody. Up here on stage. Just. There's so many. How many can do it and say, I can do it in a foreign language? What? Let me hear you. Okay, come on up. I'm paying $4 for this. But can he do it? I'm paying $4 for these push-ups. Yeah, right down here so we can all, at least everybody over here. Can do a count. Help him count.
He did it!
Congratulations! Hold that up. Show everybody, Joshua.
All right,
let's go. Oh, just a minute. Now, unfortunately, your tax is 70 is in the $3 out of every $4. So here's your tax, and that's what you get. I have programs for people. If I have programs for people, will you vote for me?
Yes.
Yes.
Who else? Programs. We just had a remarkable lesson that is true to life on what happened in the American economy in the 1930s. Let me explain this in a little bit more detail. Once the tax rate went up to 63%, we find that the people like Joshua, they might have worked for a little while, but if I have Joshua for another 10, he might not be so eager with my $4 price, knowing he's only going to get one. The investment dried up. Franklin Roosevelt ran for president in 1932 in this environment, and he said, what I'm going to do is have more programs. He said a bunch of different things. For a while, he said, oh, the spending is terrible. But then he said, well, we actually need to do more. The socialists were saying we need to take every industry in the country and make it government operated. And now this is, we have hungry people. Unemployment had gotten up to 25%. We need to have food to make sure no starving people. And we need to have what they call public works, like infrastructure projects, roads, dams, and this kind of thing. so that people can have work. They're building a road because private enterprise is backing off of investment because of the high taxes and the tariffs and everything. So then we'll have the government do it, and then we'll have more of a socialist economy. Franklin Roosevelt bought into this when he beat Hoover in 1932. When he ran, he got the tax rate up to 79%, even more than the 3 out of 4. But Joshua, I won't make you give another quarter back from that. I'll let you keep it. But that rate was run. And now, in effect, Roosevelt is saying this. And you have a handout that I gave you, and I want to go through this a little bit. Because this is the first program of government relief. They called it relief. We call it welfare today. In the 1930s, money for that was given to people to live on, to eat, was called relief. And it was called the Emergency Relief Act of 1932-33. And this is the first federal welfare program in American history. Now, what I've done here, and I have lots of sources here cited, because I know some of you go home and you have a class and somebody says, "Where did you get that?" And if you say, "Well, Dr. Folsom told me." "Well, I don't care what he says." Well, you have other sources here that are recording it and documenting it. So I put that in there. Now, the top 8 states from 1 to 8, you go from Illinois, Pennsylvania, New York, Michigan, Ohio, Wisconsin, California is number 7, and West Virginia is number 8. Back then, we didn't have Alaska and Hawaii, so we had 48 states. And Maine through Wyoming are number 41 through 48. I've eliminated the middle 30-plus states, 32, to just focus on the top 8 states receiving money out of this $300 million. $300 million are being allocated, and out of that $300 million, this is who's getting what. The bottom 8 states, Maine, Maryland, Massachusetts, Connecticut, Vermont, Delaware, Nebraska, and Wyoming. Now, I'll admit right off, those bottom 8 are not as rich, or as many people as the top 8. But you know what? There are some exceptions. I mean, Maryland's bigger, isn't it, than West Virginia, and Massachusetts bigger than Wisconsin. In other words, you see some of those that are getting zero. Illinois, does it strike you as interesting that Illinois gets more than New York and California put together? Even though it's much smaller. The $300 million was distributed that the governor and mayors would go to Washington and say, "We have these needs, we need," and then they'd give the amount. And then the bureaucrats in Washington with the Democratic Party would decide whether they get that amount or not. Why do you suppose Illinois got 20% of all the money given, and Massachusetts with Boston and all of that got zero? Friends in Office. Friends in Office is a good movement in the right direction. Yes. Do you think they're going to be open to Democrat governors or Republican governors?
Democrat.
Illinois is a swing state. Plus, Illinois did something clever. New York was one of the first. Did you see? New York gets up there, 26,600,000. Illinois came in, and they, I just think the thinking on this, New York got 26 million. How can we, when we're, New York's twice as big as we are, how can we ask for twice as much as New York and get away with it? And the answer is, or go ahead.
Sorry, you're not supposed to.
No. That was what was passed by Congress.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Congress passed $300 million.
They just figured, okay.
Yeah, they said...
we can spare $300 million.
$300 million. And, of course, it's going to be enlarged later. But this was the first, okay. The first round. That's good. And Illinois is sitting there... Now, listen, which sounds more persuasive if you're Illinois? To go in there and say, "Well, New York had 26,600,000. Boy, we could sure use, say, 30 million. Boy, we 30 million, please." Or to say, "We're from Illinois, and we've calculated our unemployment rate. And we need 55,443,721. And they may have had some sense on that. They've rounded that. Doesn't that sound more impressive? boy, these guys know what they need. And he was a swing state. This was very important because the Illinois senator, whose name was Dietrich, the senior senator, was a key vote for Roosevelt. Roosevelt wanted to control the Senate, and the Senate majority leader died in the Democratic Party. And so Dietrich was the swing vote. There were 37 senators for Barclay, who was from Kentucky, and 37 for Harrison, who was from Mississippi, two Democratic senators. And Roosevelt wanted Barclay. And so he called Dietrich up and said, vote for Barclay. And Dietrich said, oh, okay. So when the Senate Majority Leader died, Barclay won by 38 to 37. And Illinois was nicely rewarded. Illinois, in other words, had the political ties that Massachusetts, I know you're sitting there thinking, well, I thought Massachusetts was a Democratic state. You have to reverse a lot of what it is today. The South was Democrat back then, and New England was Republican, mostly. And so Massachusetts is mainly a Republican state, although they had a Democratic governor, but they were mainly a Republican state. Now Massachusetts, here's what I'm getting at. I want to read this now. Massachusetts had to take unprecedented action to raise local money for relief, all the while paying taxes. See, the income tax had been pushed up to 79%, and we're also going to get, because Margaret Thatcher, you know, Prime Minister of England, said the problem with socialism is that pretty soon you run out of other people's money. And we were running out of the wealthy people because we were taxing them all, so you have to get money from everybody else. And they thought, how can we do that easily? And they said, oh, with sales taxes. We had the first gas tax. It was 1 cent a gallon. California today pays about 74 cents a gallon. 20% of the price of gas in California is tax. It started 1 cent a gallon. Cigarette tax. See, that way you hit smokers. You want to be sure to hit these lower income voters here. Hit them with a sales tax. Gas. Cigarettes. And so all of these kinds of taxes came in. They had a tax. They found out people are so depressed, they're going to the movies to watch Walt Disney. Or to watch the Marx Brothers because they're so depressed. And so Roosevelt had the tax on movies. So we have a tax on movies. And so movie tickets are going to be, we're going to get, we had a tax on telegrams. Yeah, we had taxes on lots of things. And so that was a fundraiser. Now, here's what I'm saying. In Massachusetts, there are lots of people in Massachusetts who smoke cigarettes. Oh, and liquor tax, too, who drink beer, fill their cars with gas, watch movies. So a lot of that money in Massachusetts is flowing to Washington, D.C. Plus, they have rich people, some in Boston, who are having to send lots of income to Washington. So they're not only losing all of that money to Washington, D.C., now they have to pay for their own poor people. I have down here, Massachusetts had to take unprecedented action to raise local money for relief, all the while paying taxes so that Illinois and other states could grab relief. Now, you might say, why are we in? They're going back. If they were to say, why are we in this depression to begin with? It was not because of capitalism of the 20s, the inventions of Lionel Sternberger, air conditioning. It was the government intervention through the tariff, the Federal Reserve, and the taxes. What I'm telling you is that government intervention was throwing the economy that was running so smoothly into disarray, and now we're having more government to try to get us out, and Massachusetts is really caught in this. Look at what Massachusetts did. Number one, they had a statewide unemployment drive raising over $3 million. See, they're trying to get that $10 million or whatever that other states were getting. The Boston Civic Symphony repeatedly gave concerts to raise money for relief. Boston College and Holy Cross played an exhibition football game for charity. A fundraising wrestling match at the Boston Garden raised $5,000 for local relief. I know $5,000 doesn't sound like much, but back that's money that would be about $80,000 to $90,000 and was very helpful in purchasing power today. The mayor of Boston raised $2.5 million from city employees. Now, this impresses me. The city employees are voluntarily giving money to feed poor people in Boston. Now, this impresses me even more as a teacher. The Boston school teachers donated 2% of their salaries for 6 months to feed the poor. Massachusetts is paying a lot of their money in federal taxes that go to Chicago and end up in Illinois, because Illinois is a swing state. And Massachusetts end up sending all that money out, and they have to feed their own poor, and so they're worse off financially than ever. Historian Charles Trout, a Columbia University PhD and college president, who studied Boston's amazing efforts to meet local needs, wrote this, quote, "No major city assisted so high a percentage of its jobless as Boston did in the early 1930s. And I cite the book. Joseph Ely, who was a Democrat and the governor of Massachusetts while this happened, concluded, because, see, he did not go to Washington and say, oh, I want lots of money, and he was kind of rejected a little bit by Roosevelt anyway, but he said, hey, the Constitution says we need to take care of our own people, so he didn't eagerly go in there. And here's what he said. Democrat Joseph Ely, governor of Massachusetts, concluded, quote, whatever the justification for relief, the fact remains that the way in which it has been used makes it the greatest political asset on the practical side of party politics ever held by any administration. What I want you to think of when you think of this relief, because this is tragic, 25% unemployment, people being hungry. In my research for my book, New Deal or Raw Deal, I would encounter these heads of households, these men who'd say, I want to go into town and try to sell something. They would have products to sell. They'd come back home and having worked all day and sold nothing or almost nothing. And you've got children at home who are hungry. Now, the free market person would say, cut the tax rates, the investors will invest, and you'll be able to get a job. Roosevelt says, no, keep the tax rates high and on all these sales tax items, so from as many people as possible, I can bring in all this money and redistribute jobs. And my point is, isn't it interesting the way the relief money was redistributed? We have a whole bunch of states who get zero, and Illinois gets almost 20% of the $300 million, more than New York, California, and Texas combined. I want you then to think, see, because the typical presentation of the way, and this is important, feeding people, the typical presentation is we had a tragedy, we had people who were hungry, and that is true, and it was a tragedy, and therefore the government, quote, had to step in. No, we could have freed up the economy, but no, we're not. The government had to step in to make sure that hungry people didn't go hungry. They didn't have to step in. They could have lowered the taxes and freed up the economy, or they could have maybe let Massachusetts have some. You always think, don't you? We have a group of hungry people, and we need to feed them. So let's have the government step in, and then once your thought process there, it's always, oh, now the problem is solved. The problem was increased in Massachusetts, and it made Chicago dependent upon federal money, and it has never gotten over that dependency. Interesting. That's why I say, as a historian, you want this socialism, or you want, in this case, a version of it, and one of it is redistribution. What happens when you redistribute? And the answer is the politically connected get lots of money, and those who are not politically connected pay the taxes that subsidize this new socialist scheme. On relief, I want to go to the whole question about the jobs, the public works. What do you think is going to happen with public? Now, would that be success? This is jobs. Is that going to be successful and people get jobs and that's going to be, is there a possible problem with that? Yeah, who can help me here? What might be a possible problem? Yes, sir. That's a good, now actually, that's a good one. That wasn't the one on my mind, but you are right. Explain that.
People who have different skill sets are capable of doing higher jobs, and people who are not as intelligent or well-versed in different job applications do other jobs, and it's hard to balance that with salary, especially when people are...
It is. Because I was in Kentucky and in Alvin Barkley, the majority leader's district, when I came to Kentucky to teach, they showed me all these New Deal projects all over, including the street that I lived on was paved by the New Deal, by the WPA. And I talked with a guy, an old-timer, who was there when it happened. And I said, were you there when Roosevelt's WPA paved the streets? And he just went, oh. They're the laziest people I've ever seen. They knew they had a job, and they weren't qualified to do it. And so the road was, it looked like the Transcontinental, you know, a little bit. And sometimes it was paved well. And he said, finally, the city had to come in with our own money and redo it. Now, some WPA projects were done better. Not every, but that was the case here. Yeah, skill level is something. What about the whole business of who gets what? Right? See, it's back to, oh, we have unemployment. Now we're going to give jobs out. The government's doing it. Let me read something. Because I thought, let me see if I can help you with this. The WPA, the Works Progress Administration, was what did the jobs under Roosevelt. I want to read these quotes, see if this helps you see where... Now, mind you, all these taxes are coming in from all these states. They're coming into Washington. And now, where's the money going for public works, road building, and whatever? V.G. Copeland, the Democratic County Chairman of Indiana, explained his position clearly. What I think will help is to change the WPA management from top to bottom. Put men in there who are in favor of using these Democratic projects to make votes for the Democratic Party. James Doherty, a New Hampshire Democrat, agreed. Quote, he's a New Hampshire Democrat. It is my personal belief that to the victor belong the spoils, and the Democrats should be holding most of these WPA positions so that we might strengthen our fences for the 1940 election. It's nice when they're blunt and tell you why they want the money, isn't it? By the way, if you weren't a Democrat, you didn't get the money. You say, well, who gets the jobs? Well, New Hampshire gets a bunch of it, but then it goes to people who have to show party loyalty. And by the way, October was never a month when you were working on the roads. You were handing out campaign literature for the Democratic Party. And the person who exposed that won a Pulitzer Prize for it. Yeah, his name was Stokes, and he won a Pulitzer Prize for exposing that. That's what, in October, nobody was building the roads. Frank Towey is a congressman from New Jersey. Here's a speech that I'm quoting from. He's in Newark, New Jersey. Quote, in this county, there are 18,000 people on the WPA. New Jersey was a swing state and went for the Democratic Party. In this county, there are 18,000 people in that county on the WPA, on road building. With an average of 3 people in the family, you have 54,000 potential Democratic votes. Can anyone beat that if it is properly mobilized? I say this again. You're going to distribute jobs? You march to Washington, and those with the best political connections, in this case in the Democratic Party, get the jobs. They get an abundance. Their areas are starting to prosper. I have to say this because the unemployment was double digits in 1936. It was still high. It was not 20%. Well, actually, it went back to 20%. Unemployment was 20% at the end of Roosevelt's second term. See, I have to explain. It's 20% when he begins, and you have about the same number of people unemployed, although it dipped for a while, but then it went back up. And so you had, at the end of his second term, the same number of people unemployed. Because if you're going to tax one group to give programs for the other, you're redistributing. It's the socialist. You're not creating a job because those jobs that got created got taken by the people whose money was lost there, and they could have bought other things that would have created jobs. So you really haven't done much. We simply doubled the national debt in Roosevelt's first two terms without solving the Great Depression. We had just as many unemployment, much unemployment, as we had earlier. But I have to say this to explain. How did Roosevelt win in 1936 when you still have such high 15% back then unemployment? It's the only time a president has won an election with 15% unemployment. And he carried 46 out of 48 states. And a lot of people say, oh, it shows how popular he was. It shows how he manipulated the people in those states to try to get some money. Let me explain here who was running in 36. In Pennsylvania, I just want to read this, Joseph Guffey, senator. He's campaigning, and he says, now he's campaigning for senator in Pennsylvania. And he says, in less than 2 years under President Roosevelt, Pennsylvania received $678,074,195 in federal money. The Hoover presidency, by contrast, Pennsylvania only obtained $12,800,000. In other words, when Roosevelt was president, we got $678,000. Under Hoover, we only got $12,000. Vote for me, I'm a Democrat, and I know Roosevelt, and I'll help bring in the money. Here's what he said in one of his campaign advertisements, which I saw and printed here. He said this, President Roosevelt, I mentioned, President Roosevelt has given us $678,000, I'll round it off, he gets down to the last dollar, $678 million contributed to Pennsylvania by the Roosevelt Democratic Administration. Pennsylvania, in taxes that came out of the state, it was under $300 million. In other words, we got $678 million in money from the federal government, and the tax revenue from cigarettes and sales tax and income tax was $300 million. In other words, we got twice as much in as we paid out, and you can see what's going to happen if we do this for Massachusetts, can't you? They paid out a lot more than they ever got in. Pennsylvania is benefiting like Illinois. And the man doing the distribution was a man named Farley. And as the Chicago Tribune noted, Illinois, Mr. Farley saw to it that the benefit checks went out for the most part just a week before the election. I present them because, see, you have to explain it. When you're talking about Franklin Roosevelt, they say, look, we have people and they're highly unemployed. And now we have programs like the WPA. And look at the picture in the textbook. They're working. And look, in 1936, Roosevelt wins 46 out of 48 states. This was a good thing to do. This is what happened in the New Deal. I don't just document it here, and I know not everybody won't want to get my book, New Deal or Raw Deal. That's why I say go online, where you have that www.trueamericanhistory.us, and I talk about that from the American pageant textbooks, which says Roosevelt was the man of the hour. And I go through that and do the citations from the textbook, because students, you need to understand, once you say, oh, let the government do it, that doesn't mean the problem goes away. It means the problem is politicized and goes into politics, which means that revenue is now going to be distributed to its in the ways that it is most politically advantageous to the party in power. You cannot go on forever, and Roosevelt kept increasing taxes on everybody. Finally, by the 1940s, especially with World War II, we had tax rates of 25% on all income over $600. All of a sudden, most Americans are paying taxes. And the rate on the upper group, Roosevelt suggested, should be 99.5%. In other words, if you earn $200,000, you get to keep how much? Less than that. $200,000, you get to keep $1,000. Does that affect your incentives to earn? If you earn $200,000, you keep $1,000? I wonder why we kept being in a Great Depression without private enterprise to bail us out. They just backed off. They're not going to expand. Even though Roosevelt didn't get that through, they thought maybe he's going to. The tax rate's already 79%. Now Roosevelt wanted 99. Then he tried 100. And then we had a debate in the Senate in 1943. In my book, FDR Goes to War, which my wife, Anita, co-authored with me. And he was so mad that the Senate wouldn't pass the 100% tax that he said, we're going to have 100% on all income over on millionaires, 100.6%. If you make $1 million, you owe $1,006,000. It's debated in the Senate. I look through the documents and I'm quoting them. Happy Chandler, Democrat from Kentucky, says, all of us owe the government. We owe it for everything we have, and that is the basis of obligation. And the government can take everything we have if the government needs it. The government can assert its right to have all the taxes it needs for any purpose, either now or any time in the future. Oh, yeah. It's one guy voted against. I mean, Charles Gifford said this, a congressman from Massachusetts, which was Republican back then. How does he pay? For three long, this is a three-year scheme for 100.6%. For three long years, he has to pay more than he receives. How does he pay his other taxes? How does he meet his living expenses? How many think that's a good question to ask on the floor? How many are happy with the congressman asking that question? We don't often clap for Massachusetts, we just did. Representative Jerry Cooper, who's a friend of the president from Tennessee, he said this. He's defending the 100.6. It may not be possible. Now, this is profound. I've got a profundity. Everybody ready for a profound moment? It may not be possible to pay more than 1 year's taxes out of 1 year's income. Isn't that like it? It may not be possible. But with few exceptions, the persons in the higher brackets have assets they can use to pay it. They can sell their house. That's the defense. That happened in this country in 1943, that debate. The Republicans defeated it, and Roosevelt had to ultimately settle for a 94% tax on all income over $200,000. In other words, people who made over $200,000. So if you made $300,000 on your last $100,000, you got to keep $6,000 and only send $94,000 to the government. You had to pay huge taxes on the first $200,000, but it wasn't up to $94,000. And then it was progressive. And then after that. I say this to you because I want you to understand that what happened after the war was over, the Republicans got in, they cut the income tax. They cut the sales taxes. They freed up the economy, and we got out of the Great Depression. Because that generation listened to the Reagan, in effect, what we would call today the Reagan quote, freedom doesn't, we don't transmit it in the bloodstream from one generation to another. But they did. That generation learned the lesson. We don't want to do this. We got out of this, and we had a period of liberty. I'm born not long after that. I'm born in 1947. What happens is right after that stuff was repealed, we got rid of the 94% tax. And what happens is it freed up the American economy, and I got to live my dream of being a college professor. It was an open economy. I got to live it. I got to live it because we had freedom, and we voted for freedom, and our politicians voted for freedom. My final statement, one of the reasons I'm here is so that you, to try to give you the knowledge and information to help you so that you will preserve the freedom. You'll get to enjoy the life and live your dreams and things you want to do and work your way up. And sometimes there's struggles. It's not always easy, but you push, you study, you work for it, and you have a chance to reach it, and you get your chance. I want you to have the same chance that I did. I had the chance because that generation, right after Roosevelt, said, no more, we're going to give up socialism, we're going to go with capitalism. I had my chance. It is your obligation to give your generation, in which you're kind of a little bit sometimes outnumbered the way I was not. It's going to be harder for you. You can do it. Go for it. Capitalism works. History tells us that story. Socialism does not work. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Joshua, I only gave you $1. You get my book. Who can I give this to on the income tax? Thank you. Let's have some questions. That's the advantage of sitting up front. Yeah, flip him for it. Go for it.
So we have a question from Lily Shiloh from San Diego, California. Her question is, what is your opinion of AOC's Green New Deal, and what overlap do you see between it and FDR's New Deal, as she has used the play on words to sell the bill to the American people?
Right. I always thought that's interesting, because I hope after today you think of the word New Deal in not so positive a way. And that's what I would say to AOC. AOC never had the advantage of having someone teach her these truths. She went through school as an undergraduate at Boston University, apparently didn't get it. I really believe when most people hear the truth and they hear historical information, they follow. And I like to think that she would, if she had just heard that, maybe at a younger age. It's going to cost $93 trillion, the estimates are, more than we earn. We're going to lose the advantage of all the gains that we had in the 1800s and 1900s with the gas industry, with the fossil fuel and all of that. I think it is a total disaster. Thank you for asking. Yes.
So I spoke earlier. I'm Jonathan Harding, and just to restate that.
So yes.
My great-grandma Julia, she died last summer, but she was 104. She was born in almost 105. She was born in 1913, which I think is the same year that the income tax was brought up,
it
right?
It is, 1913.
So her entire life, long life, they've had the income tax. I just wanted to ask you, because I personally disagree with it, just on principle, what was the motivation behind it, and why do we still have it today?
The income tax was, you say, what's the motivation, why do we still have it today? We still have it today because it was sold as the idea we're only going to tax the rich. In fact, the slogan that you sometimes heard with the income tax was, don't tax you, don't tax me, tax that guy behind the tree. If you only tax the top 1 or 2%, then you have the following situation. What I'm saying is you're going to have to be able to pass it because, look, I come into a room. I'm a politician. There are 100 of you. The average is that 1 or 2 of you will make enough to pay income tax, and the other 98 won't. So I come in and say, I have programs for you. Some of you may get them. And all of you, except 2, will have to pay, only 2 will have to pay for it, and the rest of you may get free programs. How many of you like that idea? Of course, they didn't know 20 years later it was going to 30 years later, it was going to be 94% on rich people under Roosevelt, and the poor people were going to have to pay 25% of all income over $600. That came later after they bought into it. And then you can't get rid of it because you're hooked onto it. And then they say, well, we can't get rid of it. It's the rich's fault. They're not paying their fair share. Thank you.
This question comes from Annalise Cleveler from Rochester, Minnesota.
Okay.
She wants to know how she can help her friends understand that socialism doesn't work when they just want to get free college.
You know, I sympathize in a way because you're in a class and the professor is saying Franklin Roosevelt's wonderful. So we tried socialism on a limited scale and look, we had all these programs and people were getting food and all this. And what should I say? I think I can understand why you wouldn't. But you know, I always liked the movie Dead Poets Society. How many have seen that? What was the slogan there? Carpe diem. And I love it that those students were a seize the day group. some people are going to have to object, and they're going to have to point these unpleasant facts out in the classroom. If you're shy and you don't want to do it, at least be supportive if you have someone in your classroom who has the nerve to get up there and tell the truth. It's a seize-the-day moment, and your lives are at stake, and I hope you can get there are enough of you who will become informed on these issues, stand up and stand with fellow students who I think many of them will come around, and be willing to take the risk and defend the principles of freedom. Thank you. Yes.
Hello. My name is Mason. I'm here to ask another great question.
Well, I know you will.
My question is about the idea that you can balance the budget by increasing taxes. It was seen during the Clinton administration that they did this and that they somehow balanced the budget. And my economics professor actually thinks this is a good idea because people who are paying for it are, you know, in the top areas of wealth. So, you know, they don't have to worry about it because they can afford to pay for these programs, supposedly. And it, supposedly, if you were to balance this budget, you would see that these people that have to pay this extra tax would shift their income and savings over to consumption, so it actually would be good for the economy eventually.
Yeah, this is the old argument. If we take it away and make them do it, it's going to be good for people. Clinton, it's worth exploring that because President Clinton was interesting. The first 2 years, again, you didn't live through this, so just a quick lesson. Clinton, his first 2 years, raised the income tax. He raised it. Reagan had gotten it down from 70% to 28%. And it was boom. The economy took off big. Under Clinton, it's going to go up. Bush raised it because, again, Bush was like Hoover. He was not a Republican that was really committed to the same ideas. So it went up to 31. And then under Clinton, it went to 39.6. So the income tax, you're right, went up. We had a bit of a depression, not depression, but we went into sort of a recession. And Clinton lost 50 seats in the House, or 50 plus seats, and lost control of the House of Representatives. You know, when you have bad economic policies, that happens. Then Clinton got religion of sorts. He said, oh, let's free up the economy. He signed a capital gains tax cut, so we were cutting on stock earnings, you had to pay less. Dividends, you had to pay less. So all of this, Clinton was actually, although he did raise the income tax, he cut other significant taxes. Then the biggie of them all, with Republicans pushing, he signed the bill that changed the welfare system so that you didn't automatically receive welfare for each child for the rest of your life. It limited and capped it. And that ended up taking half of the Americans who were receiving AFDCs, which is aid to families with dependent children, half of those people went off welfare. And we had a budget surplus in his administration and the first year of the Bush the second. We all of a sudden, we reduced the role of government, the economy went up, and we had budget surpluses for the first time in years. So Clinton did some things that were good for the economy, and that's why the economy improved. He started with a bad thing. He switched, went to something much better with more freedom, and he had actually economically fairly successful terms. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Dustin from Kennedy High School in California.
Yes, Dustin.
And I want to say I wish you were my history teacher because
Well, it's fun to hang out. It's like we're having history class today.
Yeah, I know.
Let's enjoy it while it lasts.
Yeah.
Thank you. I'm glad you. That's nice of you to say.
There tends to be a bias towards the New Deal and all these FDR, like the cause of the Depression. And my question is, my history teacher says that the New Deal was socialistic but not socialist. So how would you respond to someone that would say that?
I would say I don't understand your terms. Socialistic and socialist, I see as the same thing. By the way, you've got you're in for a treat with your next speaker, George Harbison. He is going to really detail the history of socialism/communism. It's going to be great. But I can't see a difference. I'm sorry. I just can't. Can anybody else? help me with that? Yeah. Yeah, I think Franklin Roosevelt was somewhat socialist. We still had a capitalist economy, but he injected a huge amount of socialism into it, and we had double-digit unemployment for a decade, the only time in our history we've had that. And then, of course, we got out of it in the 40s, and as I say, I had a life, and I hope you get the same life. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Kristen Caswell, and I go to Classical Conversations Co-op.
Good.
I was just wondering, in your informed opinion, what do you think would have gone differently in our history if the 106% income tax had passed?
You ask an interesting question. This is called, historians call it counterfactual history, which is what would have happened if, you know, sometimes people say, what would have happened if the South had won the Civil War? And then you draw, and I don't want to get too much into that because it's all imaginary. You know what I mean? It didn't happen. But it's, sometimes I agree it's fun to think about it, right? What would have happened? I think if we had gone to the 106, that some other country would have opened its doors to entrepreneurs. The United States, as a socialist economy, would have steadily gone downward, and whoever had the gumption to promise freedom would have then received a migration of entrepreneurs, and they would be the last best hope on this earth.
Thank you.
My name is Patrick Warren. I'm from Provo, Utah.
Yes.
I was wondering what you could say about the causes of the 2008 recession. And the Bush's administration, you know, their role in that, what the Federal Reserve did leading up to it, and whether it was more the government's fault or the bank's fault?
Yeah, the banks were caught, though, because they were under government regulation. See, a lot of this, let me just give you a couple points on that, because it's a good subject, but one I can just address briefly. The 2008 recession, which you wouldn't remember, you know, it's 10 years ago, but you were kind of not really thinking about political issues back then. Probably. Some of you might have been. But the key thing where was that under Jimmy Carter, we had the Community Reinvestment Act, CRA, community. And what that did is it put banks on the spot because it said, we will give you advantages of where you can do branch banking. In other words, we'll give you all sorts of possible freedom to maneuver, but we want you to loan money to high-risk people so that they can get houses. And so the banks, but we'll have the Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, we have government agencies that will take these loans, so your risk is not necessarily going to be high. So then we have lots of loans going out to high-risk people. Then when we inevitably had a downturn, those people defaulted, the banks ended up in trouble, and many of them defaulted, and all of a sudden, people are saying private enterprise failed. But it was the government incentives that they put in place that forced many of the bankers to do this. So it's a situation where the government involvement was a key part of the 2008, causing the 2008 recession.
Thank you.
Sure. Yes, yes.
Hi, I'm Lucy Griffin from the Covenant School in Charlottesville, Virginia.
Okay.
And I just have a question about that 100.6 tax rate idea. One, how is that different than pure socialism, and do you think we would have been able to recover to a free state had that passed?
Yeah, that was sort of a little bit what the other person asked. I can't see any difference from that in socialism in the following sense. Socialism is force. And that's what you have there, force. Socialism is central planning, the industries being controlled. That part of it might be a little bit missing, so it's not pure socialism in that respect. But the 100.6% tax means is redistribution, which is all about socialism, taking from the rich, giving to the poor, going through a political process, right? Which means it's not just poor or automatic, it's the politically connected poor will be in better shape. So I think it would have been an absolute disaster. I think that it is a key part of real, honest-to-goodness socialism that we had with that proposal. We got out of it, fortunately. And again, I think that the United States would have declined as a nation right then. And I think my life would have been different and I might be doing something entirely different that I wouldn't have wanted to do if we had not repealed and voted down that 100.6% proposal, which received a huge number of votes in Congress.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. How many have ever heard of the 100.6% proposal? Oh, you have? Good. A couple of you? Okay, but see, I think, in textbooks, wouldn't it be nice to have that in the textbooks? I one time said, if you'll show me a textbook that has 100.6% in it, and it tells you that, I'll eat the textbook. Only you had to give me some mustard. And then, lo and behold, I had someone who said, I'm writing a textbook, and I'm going to include it. And once that happened, I quit saying that. Go ahead.
We have one final question. This is from Ellie Rosslyn in Portland, Maine. The question is, do you think Trump's tax cuts were enough, or should the president work with Congress to do more?
Oh, I think the tax cuts were great. Our corporate tax was the highest in the world at 35%. The Scandinavian countries were lower. Everybody was lower. Now, we got it down to 21%. Yes, I was hoping it would be 20. Congress and President Trump did a great job pulling that tax cut together, and that tax cut helps explain why the unemployment rate plummeted and is very low for women, lowest that we have in the last, I think, 60 years, for Black Americans, for Latinos. A lot of that is attributable to the incentives we gave to spend and invest with the Trump tax cut. Thank you for that question.